Hey everyone, how's it going? Welcome back to Let's Play Nioh. Before we jump into today's mission, we have a world map here which acts as our nexus of sorts. And over time we'll explore the different things that you can do from the map, but one of them that we'll do today is hit up the blacksmith. Now we're gonna come back here a couple of times, so this isn't all so overwhelming because there is so much depth to the crafting options here. This is Tome. Her grandpa is Muramasa, because we have to cram all of the historical Japanese figures in here. So you know Nobunaga's gonna show up at some point. Tome will give you some tutorial dialogue, as well as telling you about how her grandpa has kind of gone missing for the moment. So today we're gonna start with one of my favorite options at the smith, which is soul matching. It's basically like mashing up two weapons to level the base weapon up. If you played Platinum's Transformers Devastation, you have a basis for comparison to how this works. So some weapon properties from the material weapon, the one that's going to be destroyed to power the base weapon up, some of those weapon properties can be transferred to the weapon that you're leveling up. You won't always lose them. But there are a couple of conditions, like you have to have max level familiarity with the material weapon and the traits of the weapon, the ones that you would ideally like to transfer over. They have to be inheritable traits, denoted by the icon near them. Now, you don't necessarily need to know all of that, but there are a couple of little nuances that help you understand the system and get a little bit more out of it. So there's so much more to it, and we'll have plenty of time to dig into the nuances of the smith over the course of this LP, but for now, let's head into the next mission. In the north of Kyushu, beneath the mountains of Nakatsu, lies a complex warren of limestone caves created by eons of erosion. Bold rogues make their home in its shallowest levels, but even they fear to tread into its deepest depths.
A cat clock. Hanzo's ways are curious indeed.
Nagamasa to mousu mono no shigurei no kihai wa yoku shitte oru zo.
Even cats speak in these lands.
Washi ga tsuite yaru. Wale ra shigurei wa hito no shinjin. まれし忍びたま。そして荒ぶる妖怪は人の怨念より
So we let Hanzo Hattori's cat clock possess us, and I guess we speak Japanese now. And about that cat clock, I didn't even think to look this up until Forrest mentioned it in the comments for the last episode. But he mentioned that he read a Japanese myth about how ninja would tell time by looking into cat's eyes in grade school. Until he made that comment, I didn't really think that much about it other than weird idiosyncrasy, but this is apparently an older myth. That ninjas would use a cat's eye sundial where you would approximate the time of day based on how dilated the cat's eyes got. That is a hell of a detail to include in this game. We're gonna pick up another one of the key pulses that let us dodge to recover our key, which I think is just super important anytime you're specializing in a weapon to pick all those up. They let you kill two birds with one stone. They keep you more active. I think they're some of the strongest abilities in each weapon's skill tree. So there are 8 Kodama in this mission. I can tell you with almost absolute certainty that I'm probably not getting all 8 in this one. One, because some of them are really well concealed, and two, because my brain doesn't work so well with networks of caves. Coming around this corner, you want to make sure that you watch out for those bats. They knock the body that was on the cliffside over the edge, and they can do the same to you. Not those bats in particular. The first time they throw the bat trap at you, it's just a learning experience for you. Oh, shit. It's just a learning experience for you. There is that the guardrail on the cliffside, so they can't quite knock you over the edge. It is OSHA approved. But as you go deeper into this network, this warren, they stop being so considerate. And the bat ambushes will often either knock you into danger, into a disadvantageous position, or they will straight up knock you to your death. So there are two ways that you can deal with that. When you suspect that there are a nest of bats nearby, you can slowly edge your way forward to bait them out, to trigger them prematurely. Or you can just go around the trigger into the cave, rather around the corner into the cave, blocking. Sometimes it'll look a little bit dicey, but as long as you're blocking, I don't think they ever knock you far enough away to where you can fall off a cliff. Almost didn't notice the dude with the two katanas lying in wait over here, and we have the first Kodama of the mission. This one is deceptive in how obvious it is. It's deceptive because it makes you think, oh, it shouldn't be that bad to find the rest of the Kodama in this mission. No, some of them suck to find. Some of them really, really suck. And again, brain no work well, cave. Because there are very few real landmarks here. Oh, what a bastard. What a prick. What a bastard. Just waiting for you to open the door. And then he is back up as well. That's high stance. It's scary to get close enough to them to whirlwind kick them when they're blocking. Because again, I said this before, but the spear users are one of the few weapon type enemies that can contest your own Kasarigama's range. And they have some pretty wild movesets themselves that can really vary between horizontal sweeps and using the full poking range of the spear. So coming up, we have something so goddamn cool. I'm so excited about this. When you come across walls with eyes, you know you have encountered a nurikabe demon. This is a mix of a mimic and an illusory wall. So this guy was crushed to death by a nurikabe for his neutral behavior. So let's try displaying some positive behavior. No, that just pissed it off. You can tell because his eyes got red. So that means that by process of elimination, if we threaten him or use some kind of hostile gesture, he will let us pass. Fucking nurikabes are so cool, you guys! So you can fight them, or you can figure out what kind of gesture it will respond to let you get past. So that revenant gives you a hint. It was killed for expressing neutral behavior, so we knew that the nurikabe didn't like that at all. It would respond with hostility immediately. That leaves you two options. You can use a friendly or a hostile gesture. Since friendly pissed it off, by process of elimination, we knew that the hostile gesture would scare it into letting us pass without a fight. That's why the gestures, by the way, in the menu are color-coded, so you can discern the type of behavior they adhere to. Neutral, friendly, or hostile. We got the boss's room key. That is not a boss room key, that's the key for the locked door up above. I think the nurikabe are some of the coolest things about this game. Like, some of the coolest enemies. I really, really dig them. We can't get ambushed by this man. By this sweet, sweet katana boy. There's so much detail and nuance in every, like, element of this game. So we are gonna backtrack just slightly. This is the room where asshole tried to ambush us as soon as we opened the door. We're gonna head back up this ramp where there was initially a fire archer. And this is what gets opened up by the boss's room key. And inside there's a kadama and also... Whoa, the boss! The boss is taking a nap by his chest. Oh shit! I underestimated the range of that just slightly. This is what happens when you play the footsie game wrong. Cause you just take... Ooh, very strong hits. That's not gonna be enough to finish. God, the Axemen are scary. Holy shit, Axemen. Axemen have been playing the long con to get back on the channel. We did at least get one elixir. We used two against him, which is not great. So we're gonna guide that second Kodama back to the shrine, and inside the chest, we get something unique. Which is the Horagai shell. So let's check that out from the new item tab. This is awesome because you are inundated with loot, so having a tab dedicated to recent pickups is smart. Let's see, the Horagai shell is a horn made from a conch shell, blown to produce a deep trumpet-like sound often carried by mountain ascetics called Yamabushi. They're also blown on battlefields to signal or rally troops. So what this does is this attracts enemies to you when you blow it, so you can maybe break groups up. And also, while we're in the menus, again, let's go over equipment weight real quick. All of your armor has weight to it. Like, the Youngblood armor here is medium class armor with 4.9 units of weight. And you can also go into your status to see your agility, which is one of the ways that they grade your current equipment weight. Like what you're currently at, which I'll get more into in a second. So you can also see your equipment weight as a percentage of the maximum that you can carry before becoming over-encumbered. That weight ratio is so goddamn important in this game because it determines your agility, which we just saw. It was that letter grade on the stat screen. So my agility is an A. This game uses static breakpoints. It uses letter grades, and it uses color coding on the weight, like the blue, green, yellow colors of your weight ratio, to tell you about your weight, your encumbrance. So, like Souls games, the lighter you are, the better your mobility is, meaning you dodge further, your dodge has more iframes if you're lighter, and you consume less stamina when your armor is light. Also, the thing that we... just lowered. It might not seem apparent what that does right now, but you'll see in a second. It's pretty cool. So you get massive benefits for wearing lighter armor. You get better defensive properties for the heavier stuff, but I personally do not think that it's worth it. So below 30%, your agility is A, 30 to 70%. Which is an enormous window, to be honest, if you want to go for, like, a medium armor build, which is fine, is B, and it goes so on like that. I would really not recommend dipping into C for agility, like above 70%. So we're gonna backtrack once again. This is where the bats first ambushed us and pushed that corpse over the cliffside. This is what we lowered, that wooden plank platform that allows us to get to that part of the cliff where the corpse dropped. Over here is a hot spring. It will heal us up when we rest in it. Kind of a mid-level heal between shrines if you've run yourself out of elixirs, which is very, very possible. Now, I don't think the community has done the hard math of counting individual frames yet, but give it time. Like, we know that the dark wood grain fast roll in DS1 is, I think, 13 iframes, and the normal fast roll is 11, because people did the hard work of just counting individual frames. They set up, like, extensive testing to figure all that out. And I would bet money the Bloodborne Dash is more than 15. You cannot convince me it's less than that. It's honestly probably more. That fucking Bloodborne Dash is ridiculous for its iframes. The Nioh Dash at A agility feels substantially lower in its amount of iframes compared to, like, the fast roll from DS1. But you get so much more speed and mobility in Nioh by comparison. That you really want to not just rely on the iframes. They're important. It's an important tool to get used to, but you want to also, here's another one of those tricky bat ambushes, you want to really master footsies and playing outside of enemy ranges and dipping in and out. It's just as important. Now, this is something I find weird, that they throw a shrine immediately after the hot spring. But we'll just get a couple points real quick, and we'll keep it going. This shrine denotes about the halfway mark of the level. This is a much less short level. This is a much shorter level. Ugh. Clunky sins. Compared to the Isle of Demons that we started off on. Oh, you threw a stone at me, you fuck! I thought you were going for a swing. At least that rock does not hurt. It hurts your ego. It doesn't really hurt your health that much. I don't know, maybe the ego damage is more important. Makes you play worse when you get pelted by a single pebble. Nah, that felt pretty good though. So there are a couple of branching paths coming up, where I really start to lose the script in terms of where the Kodama are. I'm sure I can get 6 or 7 out of 8 of them. Ah, these bats! That one almost got me. It would have dropped me. I don't think that's that bad of a position to be in. I think it just would have triggered an enemy ambush that I wouldn't necessarily be prepared for. But also, speaking of tricky Kodama hiding places, I think this is the only one like this in this level. Oh, it sucks. Glowing, bioluminescent mushrooms concealing these silly green Kodama. So I think we're fine to head down here and do a plunging attack. Up ahead, this is another one of those nasty axe-wielding oni yokai. So we're gonna go into high stance with that light attack. Pulse away to clear the defilement. I think being able to start out with a high attack, breaking the horn, is just so handy with these. There are a couple of larger sized yokai where that doesn't work out quite so well, and we'll be fighting them later in the level. Holy shit! Yeah, the first death had to come sooner or later. Came pretty deep in, though. And that is what happens when you get reckless against the yokai. Let's give him another go. Take him a little bit more seriously. I still want to burn the living weapon against him. Because there are more important targets to save living weapon for right after him. Like, we're pretty close. That's the attack that I really want to bait out properly. The overhead that he does that leaves the defilement pool behind just happens to be the attack that leaves him vulnerable for the longest time. It's the easiest to follow up after. But it's also his most dangerous attack, so playing the game of ranges against him, you play it wrong, you just die. So you'll notice that I'm back to 8 elixir. There's a little quirk of the elixir storage system in this game that I don't think I mentioned yet. So I've said before that this game has got the soul's DNA. But to be more accurate, I think it's learned a lot more lessons from Bloodborne than it does any of the Souls games. This is actually way more like Bloodborne than Dark Souls or Demons, if you were to make the comparison at all. And part of that is in the elixirs. It's a very blood vial-esque system, which includes sending excess ones to storage, plus you have the speed of the game being a lot more reminiscent of Bloodborne. And you also have this little quirk, which is very few unique weapons or weapon types, but the movesets on them are gigantic. Between all the stances and the skill trees, the movesets are huge in Nioh. And there is a lot of combo potential, actually. Like, I remember when the very first alpha for the game came out, being astounded because people were putting combo videos together. And that flexibility has only gotten better over time. We want to wait for him to patrol back a little bit so we don't trigger him immediately at the base of the ladder. So I may have said this before, but the elixirs work as a combination of Estus and Blood Vials. So you will always have at least 3 elixirs when you respawn at a shrine. But they also refill from your storage. Like, you can by default have more elixirs than the base of 3. If you invest in a skill in, I think, the ninjutsu tree. And then if you get more than a maximum number, which is 8, they all get sent to storage, which replenishes the amount of vials, or the amount of elixirs you get when you die. And if you don't have any in storage, like if you haven't picked any excess ones up, then you just start with that base of like 3, or I think you can get up to 4 or 5 with a ninjutsu skill. So it's more or less like a blood vial system. But they make sure that you can never run out, so you never actually have to farm the elixirs, you just start with a small number. Like, you can run out of blood vials entirely in Bloodborne. It's not super likely, but if you're having a really taxing run at a boss, then you can go down to 0, but you can never quite get down to 0 in Nioh. Watch out for more fucking bats over here. We tripped them before they could even hit the block. No need to fight the yokai that was on the other side of the path. He may have been guarding another Kodama, I don't remember, and I don't particularly care either. There might be some small reward for fighting him, I don't know. And we have reached max familiarity with our newest spies, Kisarigama. I've been having fairly bad luck in picking up new ones. Which is all the more reason to use the forge and the soul matching. Just to level up your weapon. So this den down here is infested with yokai. Both smaller ones along with a larger oni. Along with a new type of yokai that we have yet to see before. You got a glimpse of him over on the left. Should be triggering him in a second after we kill this guy. This Cyclops. These ones are not nearly as dangerous as the axe-wielding yokai. They just have some deceptively quick swipes, but they don't have, like, that one-touch kill potential like the axe-wielding Oni do. Also, I think the lighting here kind of freaks out. It becomes blinding. Not sure where that light source is supposed to be, but it's more frustrating than anything. While you're rolling around in the water. Oh, no, you are finished. I really love the way those things look. They look so innocent with that big puppy dog eye. I don't know, I think they look kind of cute. Sympathy for the cute Oni, for the cute Cyclops. Cyclops Chan. Oh, but we want to be careful as we circumnavigate this room. Hug the walls, I would recommend. And try to draw the yokai out one by one. The worst thing you can do is trigger one of the yokai, panic, run away from it, and then you'll start triggering all the rest of them. There's also the one, I think that's the one we just killed that was throwing firebombs at us earlier. Whoops. So this is a smaller sized yokai that's actually weapon based. Oh, and down here, these dudes are new. I guess the closest equivalent is to the crystal lizards. But they are fast. They're very agile, and they can occasionally fight back. Like, they can tie you up. They have a lot of loot on them that you can pick up if you manage to kill them. They will try to run away, and if you let them get away, they'll disappear. Like a crystal lizard. And another Kodama trapped in the crystals. Actually, no, the first one trapped in the crystals. The last one we found concealed like that was concealed against the glowing fungus. Okay. Gotta watch for the one yokai that's patrolling around the corner around here. Oh shit! At least that's not poison. That still hurt a lot though. Normally these little yokai don't actually do all that much damage. The worst thing they can do normally is poison you. I think we got that. Oh, hello. Are you an axe one? That would have been really bad if I had got caught too off guard. That's the attack I want to see you do. When did he even it didn't even result in him leaving defilement on the ground. That's the one we want bait out. If you're quick enough to get in, you're dashing in just as the thing is hitting the floor. I think I've been a little bit slower, a little bit more prudent than I need to be. I don't like that attack. I think that one's harder to follow up. This should be the kill. Should be death. Come on. Oh, shit. Okay, good. We got that, no problem. Now, there are a couple of more Cyclopsi, along with the axe-wielding Oni. But I think we only need to fight one of the remaining yokai in here, if we do this right. Which is you. Oh, shit. That one, like the others, has that big orange glowing horn, which will immediately drain all of its ki. But it's a lot harder to hit that one because this yokai is so much bigger than the others. So let's try to get him into a more favorable position, where we can maneuver a little better. Most of the cave floor down here is pretty open. This one just happens to be in a shitty position. Oh, I can never tell when he's gonna do the two-hit combo or three. That's fine, though. His range is not great. He's a little bit faster than you might expect, but once you see him attack once or twice, the speed is not a problem. That is, though, if you get overconfident. And he does the big belly flop that the Onryoki boss did from last time. That boulder toss is absolutely not a threat. We can dispel both of these from that position. Was not sure if I was quite gonna land that last hit before his fist came crashing down at me. I think that's the last one that we actually need to kill before we head on to the boss. Oh, almost missed the Bat Warren. Gotta be something good back here, right? Yeah, not really. Just a corpse with some some Hamaya arrows. Anti-paralytic needles. They will cure the paralysis status, which the upcoming boss can inflict upon you. And judging by the lighting change, we know we're on the path to get to the next boss. There are like three of these caverns with bats that will come out at you as you approach the boss room, which I think is just shitty. There's nowhere they can knock you to. They can just chip small amounts of health and force you to use one elixir to top off with. More anti-paralytic needles, really telegraphing what this boss is going to be all about. And we're going to see what that boss is going to be all about next time. Thanks for watching, everyone. Take it easy. Have a good one.